Hello and welcome to Dialogue. From video game competitions to global events, esports have grown into a billion-dollar industry in just 20 years. Today, tournaments are watched by millions of fans around the world, and esports have become a massive industry with a huge fan base, especially in China. So how did video games become so popular? How do players make a living? And what do people think of the esports industry and where it is going? To find out more, I'm talking to Li Xiaofeng, the best-known esports player in China, and later to industry insiders from China and South Korea. That's our topic. I'm Zhou Yue. Xiaofeng, welcome to Dialogue. Xiaofeng, we know that 有个企业家一番关于电子竞技的讨论引发了一些热议，我知道你作为中国电竞的旗帜性的人物，你怎么看电子竞技它到底是不是一个体育运动？你好，我是认为作为一个电子竞技最早的从业者，我从1998年就开始玩电竞相关的这些游戏和项目，然后打比赛一直打到了2013年。 我其实，在体育这个电子竞技的体育竞赛中，我是获得了很多的这种竞技对抗的一些乐趣，所以我本人呢是持有这个积极和正面的观点。我认为电竞是一项竞技体育运动，只是说它可能不像我们平时所熟知的篮球、足球这样有那么多的激烈的身体对抗，但它在脑眼这样一个相结合的对抗上，在一种这个大脑的对抗上，我觉得是丝毫不弱于其他的这些体育运动的。
有一项最近的发展可以证明，它确实被很多人认可。比如说，电子竞技成为2022年杭州亚运会的正式的比赛项目。如果这是一种趋势的话，那对电子竞技的从业人员和他的观众、爱好者来说意味着什么呢？我觉得这是一个对于我们很多从业人员和观众来讲。 是一个特别好的消息，因为在很多年前，2003年的时候，我们知道国家体育总局把电子竞技列为正式的体育项目。那在陆陆续续这么多年以来，我们都没有加入到像亚运会这样一个正式的国际的体育的大舞台中间。那在这一次2022年能够正式的入选亚运会，对于我们来说，这代表了这个我们的体育的这种。 大的传统型的赛事对于电竞的这个新兴项目的一种认可，同时呢，也会更好的鼓励我们的中国的选手们能够在世界体育的舞台上去争取更好的电竞项目的成绩，也能够让更多的观众能够不仅仅说是在互联网上能够看到我们的这个电竞比赛这个项目，可能我们在传统的这些媒体上在亚运会举行的时候，我们也可以看到电竞相关的比赛项目的信息。
对于我们来讲，真的是一个特别利好的一个消息。那你有没有设想过，电子竞技会有朝一日登上一个更大的舞台，成为奥林匹克比赛的一个项目？当然，从2008年我作为中国的这个奥运会火炬的这个火炬手的那一刻起，当时就有我们国内就有很多的讨论和议论，说是不是在不远的将来可能说。 电竞竞技就能成为奥林匹克的正式比赛项目，但是2008年到现在为止13年过去了，那电竞也是仅仅刚刚入亚，所以说我很看好未来电竞，能够去这个有入奥的可能性，但是时间还有多久呢？可能还需要另外一个13年，或者说是更久，我们自己可能也很难说得清楚。
不过我也记得在电竞刚刚诞生之初，很多的玩家也遭到一些。 指责和怀疑，比如说家长和学校会反对学生从事电子游戏、电子竞技，认为这是一种干扰和妨碍正常的学业成长和事业追求。我不知道你怎么看这些年人们对电竞的态度的变化和这个变化对这个行业意味着什么呢？
这些年以来，我能够感受到的切身体会就是，电竞。 在社会上的一个影响力，还有包括大家对他的态度，都在变得和像您刚刚讲的之前的那些视为洪水猛兽的那个年代的这个态度有了很明显的一些变化。 因为当大家平时在忙完工作，或者说是在自己这个忙完自己的事情之后，茶余饭后，他会把电竞或者说一些游戏当做像看一场电影一样，当做一个茶余饭后的一个娱乐的一个项目。那里面很多人他是能够区分得清楚，就是游戏和现实的一个区别的。那当然这些年我们也看到了很多的游戏公司也在不遗余力的再去设置一些青少年去玩游戏的一个时长的限制，家长的这个监控制度等一系列的制度让这个青少年能够更好的这个区分这个游戏和现实的区别，从而能够更加积极健康向上的去玩游戏。
很显然，它是现在很多人的一个选择的生活方式了。我知道你在这个行业里是个佼佼者，甚至是很多人的偶像，那对于想从事这个行业，甚至想成为你这样的选手的青少年，你有什么建议？怎样才能成为一个职业的选手？
我认为，我自己也是一个传统体育的忠实爱好者其实曾经有一度我也想成为传统体育的一些职业选手但是我后来发现，这个
什么
太
项
难
目
了，因为有些时候这真的是跟，比如说我自己特别的喜欢这个篮球，但是呢，你像我的身高是永远限制了我不可能成为一个篮球的一个职业选手的，可能说就是在自己的校队里面跟一些其他学校然后比赛一下，可能就已经很满意了。
啊？
那但是呢，对，因为而且我在
然后
从
你在
事传
电
统
竞
项
中
目
发
的
现
这
了
样
你
的一个训
的
练的时候，
特质和天分。
对，可以这么说吧，是因为也可以说是因为我可能是属于那种天生就有很强的胜负心和竞技心的这样一类人，所以说我很希望在某一类项目中去这个把自己的这种胜负心的这样一种天赋给它发挥到极致。那当后来我了解到电竞的时候，我就发现了有这样一个舞台。但是呢，其实坦白来讲，我并不认为这条路是很好走的一条路。传统体育我们就不用讲了，大家都知道，你要流血流汗，同时你要付出很大的努力。其实我想说的是，电竞和我想成为一个篮球的这个职业选手当时一样，它不光有天赋的要求，它也有天赋的要求，同时它还需要你像传统体育那样，就是你要日日夜夜不停的在这个自己的游戏的平台上去磨练自己的技术、技巧、肌肉记忆等1万个小时、10万个小时定律这样一些努力，然后你才有机会成为职业选手。因为这里有一个很残酷的数据，我可以告诉大家，就像我刚刚讲的，中国我们可能有将近上亿的这个爱好者在玩着电竞相关的游戏，但整个中国的职业选手的数量，我认为可能并没有超过1万个人。也就是说，无论有多少人想成为职业选手，但是其实中国的这个现存的职业选手的这个人数是1万个人，
所以
而
从
且
某
在
种
短
角
时
度
间之
上
内，
讲，
我觉
它
得可
比
能。
很多传统体育项目更具有竞争性，因为它的玩家的基数如此之大，但是顶尖者却如此之少。
对，我们可以看到任何的这个残酷的体育项目的竞争之中，其实顶尖者都是很少的。所以说，我希望就是每一个，如果说你有梦想，你想成为职业选手的话，你可以来考虑一下这条路。但首先，你要从概率上明白，你能不能成为这个1亿个这个爱好者之中那其中1万个人呢？这个可能是一个值得我觉得去思考的一个问题。然后这样，你才能够去更好的做好自己的人生规划和你自己的职业规划。
还有一个就是关于这个职业的生态，我知道很多选手可以达到拿国际冠军、国内冠军，但是除了拿冠军、赢比赛以外，还有什么样的机制能够保证选手不仅仅能得到荣誉，还有能够有一个正常的营生和职业路径？我不知道你的这个经历能不能够跟我们分享。
对，我们知道，像我们刚刚讲的，其实职业选手呢，只是电竞行业的一个台前的一些人物，但是在台后和幕后，我们有更多的一些从业人员他们比如说，无论是直播平台的相关工作人员，还是说是一些赛事公司的执行人员，还有包括俱乐部的一些工作人员，其实媒体的工作人员，很多的工作岗位都是和电竞相关的。如果说你是喜爱电竞这个行业，可以考虑从事这些相关的工作岗位，这些缺口会更大，比电竞会更加的这个成熟一些，那当然，如果说你自己想作为一个自由工作者，那我们也知道，这些年在中国我们比较火热的有这个游戏主播，也有游戏的这个陪练师等等这一系列的工作岗位的人的数量可能会更大，这些是我能够去建议的一些方向。
另外一个问题就是每一种游戏可能都基于硬件的发展。我们知道电竞它始于电子计算机的硬件，而现在更加普及和强大的呢，是我们每个人口袋里的手机，它可能在很多层面上已经取代了通常我们认为的计算机在日常生活中的作用。那么你认为手机的普及、手游的普及会对传统的电竞带来什么挑战吗？
在大概2013年，当我当时退役的时候，其实是源自于手机游戏的冲击。因为在那一年的时候，很多的这些像我当时打的一个 WCG 的比赛，是因为官方赛事要转型手机游戏赛事，但在中国在世界范围之内都得到了这个大规模的抵制。那个时候呢，我们并不认可说手机游戏是能够成为主流的这个电竞项目的。但是随着这个时间的推移，现在来到了2021年，我们可以看到手机在这个所有人的生活方式中已经是必不可少的了。那很多人通过手机也是玩到了电竞相关的移动电竞的游戏，那移动电竞现在其实也成为了这个世界上的一个主流。我认为这是一个社会发展的趋势。可能对于我们来讲的话，我们作为一些电竞从业者，我们所能做的就是更好的去适应这些趋势，保证自己更好的生存，同时能够去更好的去看看有没有什么能够和产业和其他相结合，推动这个产业能够更好发展。
说到趋势，还有一个趋势就是新游戏啊，因为和传统的体育项目不同，比如说篮球、排球，可以一直保持这样的形态和竞赛规则。但是新游戏呢，不断的投向市场，可能这几年玩的游戏，过几年就不再流行，甚至不再存在了。这对游戏玩家来讲是一个什么样的概念呢？
这个我也认为恰恰是对于电子竞技的职业选手来讲最为残酷的一面，而且对于电子竞技的这些行业从业者来讲很有挑战的一面。因为游戏的这个新老交替其实就是源自于设备的这个不断的迭代更新，你需要在不同的游戏之间去适应下一代的新的电竞游戏，来适应自己是否能够成为下一代游戏的职业选手。那对于从业者来讲，你也需要去学习新的游戏和新的这个游戏相关的知识，这也是电子竞技选手很残酷的一面。
好的，非常感谢 Sky 你的分享啊，也希望你能够在新的领域里继续开拓，作为一个积极的玩家，谢谢你啊。We'll take a short break, and later in the second half of our program, I'll be joined by some insiders of this industry to talk about where esports is heading. And for the second half of our show, I'm joined by satellite from Shanghai by Kate Han, head of LPL events and branding at TJ Sports, and from Seoul,by Dongku Kim, founder and CEO of KDKU. Welcome. Let me start with you, Mr. Kim. I know that South Korea has seen the booming industry of esports since the Asian financial crisis in 1997, when it contributed to the country's economic recovery. But two decades on, what is your experience of seeing the growth of esports in your country?
Well, first of all, esports was a contribution, but it was not the main contribution. It was just part of it. So in 1990s, government actually invests a lot of money on internet and internet system and network. And then fast internet speed led our PC bang, which we call PC room industry, to what it is now. And PC room culture,is where the Korea esports actually started it, and then it became the fundamental of esports for now. It started with industry in the beginning, but because of PC room culture, PC room made it more esports, focused on esports, because people start playing against people who's good at the games at the same PC room.And then PC rooms start getting competition with other PC rooms. And then they were putting some, you know, prizes and stuff like that. So it started all that way.
And Ms. Han, I know that China is also been exploring the industry, and esports is massive here because probably of a big fan base. It become an industry worth tens of billions of dollars. I saw a venue full of fans cheering for their teams in Shanghai. Why are esports so popular in recent years in China?
Hi, so actually esports has been initiated in China like for like a history of 20 years. But with currently, especially for this past like 3 to 4 years, more and more from the public has been aware the growth of the esports. So there will be many games, many like game developers and publishers. They started to use esports as their major marketing like methodologies and tactics. And with the growth of esports and esports like the top level esports, just like League of Legends esports, especially for LPL, we have been growing to a level similar to the new generations of traditional sports. So it's like how basketball versus NBA and how like Premier League versus like soccer. And for League of Legends esports, especially in China, we actually are trying to grow our business just like traditional sports. And also we grow our federation and teams and pro players and to reach to the top level of the management. There are also tons of support we are getting from the government. So for example, especially for the League of Legends like World Championship 2020 hosted in Shanghai last year, we have received tons of support from the local Shanghai government.
And Mr. Kim, about the popularity of esports around the world, I don't know what is the case in South Korea. Do parents and teachers encourage their children to joining esports competition, to play video games more, or do they encourage them to pursue their academic career?
Well, I mean, academic career is still big in Korean society. However, it has changed a lot since 2018 Jakarta Asian Games. So during the games, as you know, esports was a part of the competition. And a lot of parents realize that, oh, wow, you know, you can be a national team member playing esports. And that was a big turnaround in Korea. And same time, you have to understand who the parents are, who the teachers are at this stage. So 20 years ago, StarCraft was a big thing in Korea. And this, a lot of people start watching esports, a lot of people start getting involved in esports industry. And those generation are the parents right now. So they are more open than the old, or like older parents, like for example, our parents, you know. So for example, my age and then the people in 30s and 40s, they understand that and they're like, okay, if you want to be a sport player, you can be a sport player. However, you know, the issue is academically, you know, are you going to study? And that's something that you have to choose, you know, personally. But yes, you're right. I mean, it is very open right now. It's more open to public, and a lot of people are taking as a sports player, you know, if you play esports.
And Ms. Han, do you think there is a generational thing here? Because as Mr. Kim just mentioned, probably those people in their 30s and 40s also encourage their children to be part of this because they were the early beneficiaries of this game and is more conducive to this industry.
Yes, actually, I can see from the current growth of the esports industry, actually, because all the companies, including the federation and all the teams and all the related like business partners in this industry are becoming more and more professional, and they're also becoming more and more beneficial. So, and with a higher awareness for this industry, parents have more trust in like having their children to grow their like career growth or choose their career as for esports is not something equal to only playing games. And they can, and also if they send their children to like study esports or become a pro player at esports, they can be secured and they will be well supported by the a healthy environment for them to grow. At the same time, also because people are aware that becoming a professional player at esports industry are totally different than just playing games. For example, for our LPL pro players, the top pro players only have like, we only have like 100 or 200 top pro players for this country. However, there are many, many users and players are playing the game. So the difference will be very similar to how we select talented players for traditional sports.
And another thing that I'm a little interested in is how long can the top players keep at the highest competitive level? It seems they are at the peak at 20, something like that, and then they will begin to retire after 25. Is it the norm? Can professional players play for a longer time?
This is a very good question. Actually, compared with soccer or NBA, where players can play to up to their 30s and even 40s, esports pro players did have a shorter like competing time. Usually, is somewhere between like their 16s to their early 20s, which is around maybe 23, 24. Mm-hmm. Then some players after 24, they will consider their retirement and will move to maybe their next level for their career growth or development.
Is it the same in South Korea, Mr. Kim? The shelf life of professional players is not that long.
Yes, it is very much the same in Korea. And I think that's something that everybody sees the bright side is, you know, esports players, you know, big salary. It's a great thing. But then again, like Ms. Han said, you know, only a few people get that benefit. And then only that benefit stays for like max 5 to 6 years, you know? Mm-hmm. And after that, there is no, I mean, they need to build their own life and they have to build new life after that.
But the industry stay on because there are still fans, there are still championships, there are still sponsors and business models. But where is this industry heading for the future growth, Mr. Kim?
Well, I think it's growing a much higher level. I mean, it's still big, but I think there is a bigger future in this industry. Because if you look at the young generation, teenagers this age, all they talk about is games, you know? Like when we are younger, we talk about sports player, we talk about drama shows and, you know, things like that. But right now, everybody talks about games, and then boys, especially boys, they focus on esports, and all, and they want to become one of the players. So it's big. Market is bigger for me, I mean, for a lot of people. It's gonna grow up.
But do you worry about this trend? Because as you said, many young boys are too focused on video games. They spend less time in their real life, socialize with their friends, talking with their parents, or sparing some time on other activities. Will that have an impact on human growth in general?
Well, that's a very hard question to answer. However, I think this was an issue since like 2000, like 1990s, 2000, when everybody was using SNS, you know, living a cyber life. Playing games was always an issue, even in the 90s and 80s. Mm-hmm. I think there a lot of times we still can't manage the time. I mean, there's a people who actually plays a lot that, you know, concerns, you know, other people, a family. But I think there's people who still manage their playing times. Mm. And then, for example, in Korea, there was a person I met, and he had a son who was in high school, and he was playing games so many hours that he couldn't, you know, really control him. So he sent him to academy and see if you're that interested, go play in academy and see how what level you are. Uh-huh. And then when he went to the academy, he figured out he's just not the best player. So he just quit playing a lot of games. You know, that's another way I think that we can see.
So Ms. Han, what is your take? Considering that esports is really very addictive.
Yeah, actually that's a very good point. So when a player is actually playing games and then they're trying to pursue their professional career as esports, there is a huge difference there because esports will be checking on candidates like from many different perspectives, their levels of like skill, the mechanic skills, their levels of strategy planning, and how they manage the teamwork, and how they do work together with their coach are all the key elements for determining whether they could become a professional player or just a player that play games very well.
Okay.
So there are actually a very huge difference. When a kid is actually playing games, and for the environment in China, he has opportunity to participate in many of the competitive matches, such as our collegiate programs at college and City Hero Tournament that they can participate. They will know that how much difference they are for them to become a pro player. At the same time, so when they know the difference, they will aware. The difference for whether they choose this as a career, and also why they choose this as just like a game for them to spend their leisure times. So when they aware about this and they choose to play games as a professional player, they know how much they need to invest on, and they will be considered this seriously. However, on the other side, they will be just like for what we observe from our players who only play games, usually they will majorly play the games during their college time.
Okay.
And then after they have a work, so they will probably spend more time with their family and with their official career growth.
I bet that all of you agree that this is a booming industry, but financially, what opportunities does this industry present in comparison with traditional sports industry like basketball, baseball, or football?
Actually, we're similar like traditional sports. Most of our revenue are coming from selling broadcast rights and selling and work with our sponsors to get the sponsorship. So these are major revenue for us to supporting the whole ecosystem to grow and funding. So teams will be funded mostly by their owners and also their team sponsors. However, compared with traditional sports, the levels of the broadcast rights and the levels of the sponsorship, we are still seeing a gap there. Like, I cannot imagine that we already have the levels of the Nike and Mercedes-Benz as LPL's major sponsors compared with most of our sponsors for LPL maybe 7 years ago were still like electronic equipments.
And new technologies, for example, virtual reality technologies and the prevalence of smartphones, will that have any impact on how esports is played around the world, Ms. Han?
Yeah. So actually, we do have the visions of like we're gonna have our multiple products and be diversified for having the mobile esports in the future.
Okay.
And as a growth for mobile esports in China has been like 5 years. So there are also like mobile esports are running for other games. Currently, we can see their tournaments available. There are fans there. Although it hasn't hit into the level as the PC related esports, but we are seeing a strong growth trend for mobile esports as well.
All right. Thank you very much, Ms. Han, and thank you, Mr. Kim, for sharing your insights. And you've been watching Dialogue here on CGTN. I'm Zhu in Beijing. Thanks for watching.